digital world. You know, these three companies control everything from email, file storage, shopping, website hosting. Amazon has like 6 databases, which they, database centers, sorry, where they have host all of their hosting. So if you have a website that's built on AWS, it's in one of their 6 buildings that they have. It's extremely centralized, and it that I think AWS hosts something like 40% of websites or something like that, probably more so. Especially also content distribution, that's another key thing that a lot of these services are playing into and providing for us. So how do we move beyond this? We go and evolve the internet. So what MadeSafe is trying to do is build a system where servers don't become dependent, or don't servers aren't as such a central point of dependency. They can still exist within the MadeSafe internet, but we're not depending on any one of them to provide us with the services. So what does that look like? So independence from centralized servers. You won't need to trust the individuals that are running the servers or own the servers. You don't need to trust that they're good or bad actors. You don't need to know anything about them, in fact. And the cloud needs to be evolve into a distributed network. So the servers aren't these central hubs that we're connecting to. Instead, we need to be connecting out to a completely decentralized network of computers and servers, laptops, and smartphones. So you can kind of think like the concept, if you've heard of SETI at home, where people run, just provide computational resources to this, to SETI, and they just use it. It's all a volunteer basis. You're just providing your extra resources. Say you go to, when you go to sleep at night, SETI can use your computer resources to maintain the network that they're trying to build with, like, figuring out. I think they use the program to identify different planets and stuff in the universe. But take that concept and kind of expand it to the entire internet. So, and that's what MadeSafe is building. MadeSafe and independent developers. So what we're doing is building the protocol, and developers are going to be needed to build applications that run on top. And then another thing I wanted to do before getting into the technical details, I won't go too deep with technical details anyway, but before I wanted to kind of give a metaphor to help you understand how the whole thing works. And to do that, I'm going to use nature. So ants are a really interesting concept to think about, because they basically provide complexity through simplicity. So each ant you can think of as like an individual node acting in its, it has its own set of rules that it's playing towards, and working together with the colony to create something that's kind of greater than the individual ants themselves. So what do ant colonies have? They have this concept of the division of labor. So each ant, there's it can take on different roles. There are forager ants and worker ants, for example. And in addition to this division of labor, they are able to change in between the roles on a daily basis, or even when necessary. So say there's a piece of food that's right outside the nest. A lot of the worker ants that are building the nest inside can switch to the forager ant role and go and help bring back the food into the nest. And that's what makes the colony as a whole extremely resilient, because they're able to adapt with different changes, different environmental situations. And this is also kind of what enables super colonies to exist. I don't know if you knew, but there's actually an invasive super colony species in California called the Argentinian ants. They basically exist throughout the entire coast. It's one large network of ants underground. And what is interesting is that this species of ants also exists throughout the world. They've kind of invaded the entire world. I think it's mostly because of human travel, just bringing them around. However, what's really interesting is that there's super colonies of the same species in Japan and Europe. But when you bring these ants together, they act as if they are in the same colony. Usually different colonies, they have different pheromones and stuff, so they're territorial and whatnot. But these three super colonies actually act and recognize each other, kind of making it one global colony, which is extremely interesting and kind of one of the things that concepts we're trying to leverage within Made Safe. So just to reiterate, like the strength that ant colonies have is through specialization and the division of labor, and then the adaptability between the roles. The communication between the ants is also extremely necessary and recognizing each other. And then obviously numbers, strength in numbers. So keep that in the back of your mind, and as I start to talk about the technology that we're building. So the first part of MadeSafe is the MAID. MAID stands for Massive Array of Internet Disks. And what is that? So it's basically the concept that we have abundant computational resources worldwide, and that if we connect them at a really fundamental level, we can leverage all of these resources without depending on central hubs to give us what we need for services. So think of it as like a global internet for connecting devices peer to peer. Another analogy that's really interesting is you can also think of it as like a global cyber brain of sorts. So think of how neurons in the brain, they fire and they're constantly communicating with other neurons, but if one neuron goes down, it doesn't affect the brain as a whole. It's very resilient. And again, it's not through any central hub. Neurons don't connect to any central hubs at all. Completely decentralized, completely serverless. And so how this works, the basis of this is kind of built on the concept of vaults. So vaults are basically the nodes of the network. And any person with an internet connection and any device will be able to set up a vault, meaning that if you have a laptop, you will be able to set up a vault within your laptop, and you will also have the power to allocate however much resources you want to the network. So if you only have 10 gigs to give to the network, that's how much you give to the network. If you only have a small amount of CPU to give to the network, that's all you allocate to the network. So again, providing resources to the network considers your hard drive space, how much disk space you can provide, the processing capabilities of the hardware you have, and then also bandwidth and connection to the network itself is extremely important to consider. Vaults have, think again about the ants. Vaults have specific roles that they fill as a part of the network, which keep it completely autonomous. So first and foremost, they're storing distributed data. That's the base role of them, and that's what they're all gonna be doing, no matter what other roles that they're taking on. So, but I'll talk more about that right after this, but in addition to storing data, they're also, vaults are in charge of managing other vaults. They're basically processing data interactions between other vaults and verifying and checking other vaults to make sure that the data that they're holding is not corrupted. It's basically the vaults are checking each other and managing each other and verifying each other on a very constant basis. And again, like these roles are so specific that The roles that they're taking on to do these verifications are extremely specific. So one vault will only be in charge of one other vault, but only one aspect of one other vault. So it's very minimal. You don't need to trust the vaults to not have too much power because they won't know everything about the network. They don't have enough knowledge about the network at any one time to do anything malicious that would harm the network as a whole or even harm data. And these roles are chosen essentially in a random fashion, so there isn't a way to predetermine which role your vault is playing in relation, or what other vault it's managing and whatnot. It's extremely hard to predetermine that. And additionally, there is this concept of ranking. So if your vault is not doing something that if the network is detecting that your vault is acting in a way that's not normal, it will de-rank it and give you less responsibility and less power and less capabilities even to act within the network and be a part of the network. So going back, and this is kind of what makes the network as a whole extremely self-managing. And to go back into talking about the data, so the distributed data is distributed by being chopped up into chunks. At least each file will be chopped up into at least three data chunks. And these chunks are also redundant. So if you're storing in someone else's junk and you turn off your computer, it's not gonna they're still gonna be able to access that chunk through someone else's. There's at least four chunks in the network of four copies of each chunk in the network at any one time. So chunks themselves, so once they're chopped up into chunks, they go through this process called self-encryption. Basically encrypting all the chunks and mapping them to this this data map that are managed by data. That's one of the roles that data manager vaults are playing, is managing these data maps. But the self-encryption is a really interesting process. We built it just for the network. It's a brand new concept of basically encrypting the chunks based on the other chunks of the files. So say you have three chunks and you want to, and you're self-encrypting, the first chunk kind of uses the hash of the third chunk, and then the second chunk uses the hash of the first chunk to encrypt it. And it uses the file itself. So you need information about the file to be able to access it in the first place and to decrypt it. And again, these chunks are distributed independently, which ensures that the data isn't tampered with, seen by others, or deleted or unintentionally lost. And then also the communication between the vaults is extremely important. First and foremost, it currently uses the existing infrastructure. So it's using Wi-Fi. If you have a vault that you want to set up, you're using Wi-Fi to connect to the network, or 3G or whatnot. And it's important to know that the state of hardware right now is advanced enough to allow something like MadeSafe. I'm talking like routers and stuff like that. It's kind of only at a point recently that routers are able to sustain connecting using MadeSafe. So that's kind of why we're coming out developing this now and making it available very soon. So vaults create direct connections to other vaults, again, peer-to-peer and serverless. The chain of connections is what makes up the MadeSafe internet. And additionally, vaults are constant, like the roles I was talking about, vaults are constantly calling and listening for communications with other vaults. And so information about other vaults, information about data, it's a constant calling and listening process. And this is kind of what enables secure access for everyone. And that's what the safe part is, secure access for everyone. So that's kind of like how the infrastructure works. And now I'm gonna kind of talk about the resulting possibilities. and kind of the stuff on top of the infrastructure. So the MadeSafe protocol is built with several thoroughly tested and innovative crypto and obfuscation schemes. People connect to the network with total privacy, security, and freedom. It's based on public key cryptography, so people will be logging in with something that we developed called self-authentication. So it's basically this concept where when you're logging in, the network will send you an encrypted packet that you are supposed to decrypt with your key. You decrypt it, re-encrypt that packet, send it back into the network, and then data managers, aka vaults in the network that are assigned this role, are verifying you and then give you access to the network. This is a really important concept because it's actually the first time anyone will be able to log into any system without putting their password into the system itself. So there's no private key that is being stored on the network. It's all completely client held and client controlled. So now with access to the network, people can save data. You can share privately, publicly, or keep it completely 100% private and anonymous. Data can be accessed from anywhere in the world. So similar to like how cloud services work today, if you lose a device and you have an account with some cloud service, you'll be able to log in from any other device and access the exact same content you would. So it doesn't matter what device you log in from. Data can be in any format. Developers will build applications which interact with this data, so they're a very important key to this. So you can expect to see web browsing, remote file storage, messaging, social networking, VoIP, really anything that exists on the internet today, but it's distributed, secure, and anonymous by default. Therefore, these developers don't need to worry about that stuff anymore. They can work on the actual product. So that's kind of how this whole thing is coming together. And there's also an additional important component to how the network works, especially when you have human actors within the network. So in addition to the technology and the network itself, there is going to be a safe ecosystem built within. And it's based on a cryptocurrency, which we're calling SafeCoin. It's important to note that this is not blockchain-based cryptocurrency. It uses, in a similar fashion of how the MadeSafe network distributes data, similar how there's data managers and whatnot, there's going to be transaction managers. So it's a very similar process. There's no blockchain for any of the crypto currency use on here. And if you want to know more about, say, like how there's consensus and, you know, double spending, how it prevents double spending, maybe we can talk about that after, but that gets a little low level. So, but you can feel free to ask me. Within the safe ecosystems, there's three ways humans, individuals can act and participate. And the most important part is setting up these vaults, right? So there's this concept of proof of resource. And that is how 70% of SafeCoin will be distributed. Proof of resource, it's basically determining how useful vaults are, and the vaults are being set up. We're calling the individuals running the vaults farmers, they're basically constantly supplying resources to the network, and will be reimbursed through SafeCoin based on how much they're able to give and how much resource their vaults is given. So again, that's based on storage space, CPU, and connection to the internet. So if your device, if your vault isn't connected to the internet, you're not providing much value. Therefore, you would get a lower, you wouldn't earn as much save points if you would if your computer was constantly connected. So save point is also necessary to access the network. So that creates incentive for individuals to set up vaults. And that also enables the system itself to be recycled. So when you say you want to upload a large movie to the network, you might need a couple save coin or something to do that. When you pay the network to upload this, those coins go back into the pool for farming. So it's a recycling process, which kind of elongates how at what point we're thinking that the farming pool might run out. We're not quite sure. We're still doing tests on all of this stuff, but there's a lot of interesting things that come about when you're able to recycle coins. So it essentially works as if you have a vault and you want to earn save coin, when someone is able to successfully retrieve a data chunk from your vault, that's when you earn save coins. So there's no way for someone to set up a vault and then just shut it down and game the system and earn save coin that way. You have to actually, once someone gets a chunk from you, that's when it triggers to earn save coin. So this makes it an extremely granular process, much more granular than, say, Bitcoin. If you want to set up a vault on your smartphone, you will be able to. If you are only able to provide 1 gigabyte of storage space, you will be able to. You will only be storing tiny, tiny chunks of data. Therefore, when someone retrieves it, you might not be earning a lot, but you'll still be able to earn at least a small amount. There won't be this concept of pooling like there is with Bitcoin because of this granular way of distributing save coin. So that's farmers. And the second group of people that's really important for this ecosystem are builders. And builders are kind of split up in two categories. There's app developers, so the ones that are making web browsers and communication tools on the network. They will be able to embed a SafeCoin address directly into the application to earn based on how the network determines it's being used. So if your application is extremely popular and a lot of people use it, you will be rewarded SafeCoin proportionally. This is really important, especially if you think about how applications are built today, especially open source applications. They tend to rely on advertisements and other things for revenue or no income whatsoever. But with this default aspect of the network, developers will be able to earn income without having to put in advertisements, go begging to VCs or anything like that. They'll be extremely independent from outside income. And this also creates the ability for individual developers to kind of get a head start, because honestly, I don't think big corporations are going to be using MadeSafe from the beginning. So individual developers will be able to hop on, build these applications first, get the reputation for having a really useful application, say like a communication tool, and then maybe a big corporation realizes down the line that they need to be using MadeSafe to everyone's starting to use MadeSafe, and they hop on, and everyone's like, well, we already have this application that you we don't really necessarily need your application anymore. They could improve on it, and that's just the market working, but it does just give a level up to individual developers. And then the second part of builders, the second group of builders, are core developers. So right now, the MadeSafe team are basically the only core developers, but it's really important for us to disseminate that knowledge and that information. So there's actually, I don't think I mentioned this, I forget if I did, but so actually 10% of all SafeCoin will be going to application developers out of the 100% pool, and 5% of SafeCoin will be going to core developers. And that will be based on a kind of a bounty basis, so fixing bugs and finding new things to improve the network. And this, again, decentralizes the development of the network itself. We don't want one group of people maintaining the core code, similar to how Bitcoin is distributed throughout the entire world. Anyone can make more core commits to the code. And the team is working really hard to disseminate this knowledge. We're doing Google Hangouts on a fairly regular basis to talk with developers and have them ask questions to the core team, and we're putting out documentation all the time. And then the final way that individuals can interact with the network that bring a lot of value to the internet, even the internet today, is content creators. So artists, researchers, journalists, anyone that creates content that goes on the internet is important to the internet, because that's why we go to the internet in the first place, right? So in this sense, it's a little different than how developers and farmers are able to earn SafeCoin, but content creators will be able to embed a SafeCoin wallet address directly into the file that they upload, and will be able to earn from consumers on a voluntary basis. So similar to how there's like when you put a picture on Facebook and someone can like it, instead of just liking it, you can send them, consumers can send them micropayments of, you know, cents at a very, it's a very easy process. There's no barrier to entry at this point. So there isn't much of a barrier to giving a content creator even 50 cents if you appreciate, especially if it's just a click of a button and your wallet's already connected, and it's a direct payout directly to them. This automatic ability to earn, this is basically an automatic ability of the network to earn micropayments for content creators. And the network will actually suggest a payment. So if there's a really popular piece of content, it'll suggest a lower amount just because that content creator is earning a lot of SafeCoin because it's super popular. But say there's someone writing an article that's a more niche, for a more niche audience, maybe the network will end up suggesting a higher amount to pay the creator, and that's so this is basically bridging the gap between the creator and the consumer. We're not so necessarily dependent on middlemen. There can be middlemen, but at this point they're kind of forced to be actually valuable. We're not going to be dependent on, you know, iTunes and whatnot having this system where it's easy to access, because that system's already there through MadeSafe. The middlemen will actually need to innovate and, for example, be content aggregators. Like, say you want a specific kind of content, sure, you're gonna wanna go to a middleman for that, but they're gonna, again, need to provide actual value. And not kind of, they won't have the same capabilities that they do now to kind of take over the market and monopolize the market. So in the end, this is kind of like, what we're trying to do here is an ecosystem for the internet, because the meat space real world ecosystem doesn't necessarily map on to the digital world too well, especially since the digital world is so granular. You don't have like, a song isn't really like an object. It's a bunch of bits. Like, you can listen to half of a song, but what if you don't, what if you're only listening to half of the song, or, you know, you only have time to watch half of a movie or whatnot, and you still, it's just generally a much more granular process than, say, buying an object from someone. And that's what we're trying to build into the network, to kind of create this its own ecosystem. So think of it as an ecosystem for the internet. So that's kind of the main points I wanted to bring up about the network, but just to talk a little bit about MadeSafe, the company. These are pretty important points to consider. It was founded in 2006 by a man named David Irvine. And actually the team itself is based in a small town in Scotland called Troon. We have, I think we have about 15 people now. Myself and one remote developer are the two people in the US. But we're looking to expand in certain ways, not too big, but I mean, our expansion is like internally, we're looking to hire some developers, but we're mostly looking to have developers take on the projects, build applications for themselves, and be interested in maintaining the network outside of being a part of the team. Additionally, we are 100% open source and open development. So you can see every single piece of our code, even our website is open. You can see it on our GitHub account. And we are completely 100% open development. You can see every single development thing that is happening on our Atlas and sites. So it's showing you things, issues that we're working on, like the sprints that we're doing, like set amounts of like projects, who's working on what, when the issues get switched over, who's responsible for what. It's just really, it's a really cool thing to be a part of. We only set that up and made it public about a month ago, just because we've been trying to find the best way to make it public, but we've settled on this and it's working out really well. So if you're interested in actually seeing what's happening kind of on the lower levels, you can go for that. And that's one of the ways we're able to communicate directly with the community. We have a lot of community members that are developers. And additionally, we also have a lot of community members that aren't developers, and we keep in contact with them on a constant basis as well through the community forums. We actually have a contest going on right now, a design contest for the SafeCoin logo. That should end sometime next week, I think. But it's just another thing that we're trying. We definitely want as much community input as possible through this. And that kind of ties into the core beliefs of the team and what we're doing. The company structure says a lot to me personally about how the core values and kind of being able to trust that this team is doing a really good thing. We're pretty horizontal in our structure. Obviously, we all have our specializations, but it's a very, like, we get together and kind of come to consensus about a lot of decisions. There isn't one, two, or even three people that make most of the decisions. It's the group, it's discussions, and we're constantly kind of talking to each other and having meetings and stuff like that. So the company structure, I think, is another way that we're trying to sort of lead by example and show that we can work kind of more horizontally. And additionally, we are not, we're interested in sustainable funding. We're not looking to make a lot of money off of this. We're looking to sustain ourselves, make good income, but we definitely don't anticipate making a lot of money off of this whatsoever, unless SafeCoin value goes up like a bunch, you know, you never know. So the sustainable funding actually comes from the fact that we did a fundraiser a couple months ago, and that fundraiser we raised, depending on the price of Bitcoin, it was around $3 or $4 million in Bitcoin through a fundraiser that will keep us going for the next couple of years. But after that runs out, we're not raising anything else. So we're gonna be the core developers that everyone else is acting as. We're gonna be the ones creating applications and earning SafeCoin. That's gonna be our income. We don't have a plan beyond this this fundraising to sustain ourselves as like as a business per se, other than just creating applications and committing to the core. So with all of that, that's kind of what I had to say about MadeSafe. So MadeSafe.org is actually the community, completely community-run, community-started forum. That's where all the discussions are happening. MadeSafe.net is our website with lots of information, documentation and stuff. But if you have any questions, I'm open to them. Thanks.
I believe you said there was no central point of communication. How do the nodes find each other on the network?
So the nodes find each other based on it's kind of technical, but it's based on this being surrounded by other nodes. So not all nodes only know about other nodes that are nearby them, not necessarily geographically nearby them, but within the namespace. That's how they're able to identify each other. Two nodes that are completely different parts of the network aren't going to know about each other. It is kind of this chain that gets sent
around.
Yeah,
I'm asking how they find each other.
In terms of what?
Well, my understanding is you would say, go to your website, download some software, start running it, and then it's got to find some other nodes, right?
It's got to find, it has to find the data that you're trying to access. So there are these, that's where the mapping comes into play. So that's how the chunks get distributed. They get self-encrypted, but the mapping scheme is where you find the vaults.
Think about it in terms of BitTorrent, you have trackers, so you can find other people.
Which she said earlier.
But it's not based on.
So what you would say is what he's asking.
Yeah.
I see. So. It's based on this, it's based on a similar concept in terms of a distributed hash table, but instead of, you're not needing to find, so all the vaults basically know about the vaults that they need to communicate with already.
Does that happen at the beginning?
Yes, it's
for
like
how,
from,
how do you,
once.
How do you find the first vault that allows you to talk to all the other.
So if you need to, it's pretty random. I mean, it's like.
Right, but is there a IP address or a website address or
there,
a domain name embedded in, hard coded in the software?
We use IP addresses on the first hop, but after that, there aren't any IP addresses. So.
So from time to time, assuming that IP address dies, the software will have to be updated for newcomers, but people who already have it will have replaced.
Their data,
so they don't know how to get on the network even without the new software. But for the new people downloading it, they're going to have a new IP address if the old one is dead.
Mm-hmm.
That would be a central point of failure, but only for initiating farmers and anybody that's just starting on the network.
Right.
Okay.
In terms of it in itself, the way they communicate with each other is pretty complex. It is based on this constant verifying and checking of other nodes.
Yeah, I'm just asking how they find each other at the beginning. Just like somebody mentioned with BitTorrent, how they have a central tracker,
mm-hmm.
where you first go to the tracker and then everybody can register with the tracker, so at that point on you can find all your peers.
Right.
But at the very beginning you need to have someplace you need to go. You know, I mean, in the case of a natural disaster or emergency, I might get together with my friend and say, let's meet up here,
mm-hmm.
you know, at this one central point.
Mm-hmm.
And then from there, you know, we can find other places to go.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I'm asking is, how does the node that first comes onto the network, how does it find the other nodes on the network?
It finds the nodes that it needs to by the network determining which nodes it needs to find. So, if you're saving data to the network, then...
It doesn't work if I unplug my internet, right?
Correct.
Okay.
If you unless you have a mesh network set up or something like that, then it definitely needs internet access. It's very important.
Yeah. Okay.
You mentioned ranking. Who decides the ranking?
The network.
Okay, but is there an algorithm or?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't know what it is, but
okay.
I'm very high level knowledge here. So I mean, I can go into lower level things, but I'm not a developer or anything like that. So,
But is it a consensus type of thing or?
It's yeah, it is. So it's these managers. The managers do integrity checks on a constant basis. If they notice a vault is not acting in the proper manager in the proper way, say it's corrupting data or not allowing people to get access to it, it will get deranked and not be used in the network as much.
So my understanding is that these vaults will hold data but also operate on it. It will run programs on this, right? By tight running, you're writing apps for this whole thing, right? So what I'm curious about, if you know how it is that these vaults will safely operate on data that they shouldn't know about. I mean, if they're just shuffling around files or something like that, they can keep it encrypted and that's fine. But if they need to, operate on it, they need to know what's in it. There is actually a very like cutting edge cryptographical breakthrough that kind of came out that it is actually possible to operate on encrypted data without knowing what it is. But I think that's very far away from being actually used, so I doubt that that's what's happening here. So what do you know what it is? It's
So in terms of actually like the beta is actually focused on data storage.
Okay.
So we are going to be implementing computation, but that's not going to really be in the first iteration. And I know they've been thinking about it. I just haven't heard the specific details about how the processing will interact with data in that way.
Are you sure that is the intention? I thought processing was going to be done on the computer, on the computer that you're on. You download all your shards.
If you're replacing servers, you're going to need like, you know, Node.js and like all these back-end services if you want to be able to create, like, for example, dynamic websites. So not every computer is going to be able to run all of these environments. So we're going to need to distribute that in some other way as well. And that's what we're going to be tackling after the beta gets released. And by the way, we're releasing this in beta at the beginning of the year, so not too far away. Probably 2 months or so.
And so if there's a distributed web services, is there a way to distribute the domain name system, or how do people know where to go to contact the web service that they want to access? Are they going to be able to access it from a normal browser, or do they have to use a Madesafe?
It's going to have to be Madesafe specific. This whole thing is within the Madesafe network. So there will probably be like browser extensions for the existing internet to interact with both, but this is in its own namespace.
So you wouldn't be able to create like just a regular website that was distributed. You would have to be a special service
you would
to access
be,
through.
You would make a. I mean, making a website is just files, right? So you would be able to do the exact same thing.
But how would other nodes know where to go to access it? They'd have to use your
it's
software.
Based on the data mapping that is within the initial distribution of the data.
A regular web browser wouldn't know how to do that. So
a normal web browser, you're right, will not be able to interact with.
They wouldn't be able to make a normal website that other people could access.
Right. This is a new internet for sure. There is no servers. There's no way to integrate servers without compromising the integrity of the network.
I assume you guys have like a test net going on right now and you're actually using it. How is it?
It's going well. I haven't heard from the specifics of the test net in the past couple weeks, but we're on the second stage right now. We're basically writing example applications, to have something working on the network, but also to show other developers how to do things. And so that's kind of the stage we're at, where it's running at a constant basis. I could even, if I have internet,
demo it,
I'm connected to Wi-Fi, so maybe.
This is Wi-Fi transfer.
I don't have an Ethernet.
Oh, never mind.
I have a MacBook Air.
What's that?
I don't know. I think it's a new one.
Wow.
Nice.
Yeah.
SNES. They're from the UK. Yes, that's what it is. Oh, I don't have internet. But I am. Wait.
You accept the AT&T.
I already was. Like, I'm in the hotel. Well, it's there. You go to visualizer.madesafe.net. It's the actual visualizer of the testnet, and you can see the different bolts and like what they're doing and stuff. It's a visualizer with an S.
Question for you, Peja. Thank you for a great presentation. Now, how do you see in the future MadeSafe, the relationship between MadeSafe, Bitcoin, projects like OpenBazaar? How do you see all those melding together or not melding together? I mean,
yeah, that's a good question. Yeah, I've thought about it a lot. I'm also really interested, like Bitcoin is one of my, I'm super into that. That's kind of what got me into MadeSafe and finding out about MadeSafe. So I honestly think that the two technologies are complementary. The MadeSafe can actually help in certain situations, like blockchain bloat is one of a huge concerns. You know, constant growth of the size of the blockchain. I think MadeSafe will be able to help in those regards. But MadeSafe in itself is different from blockchain technology, because blockchain technology is essentially a global ledger. The fact that there are these efforts to make it anonymous and you know, create schemes to anonymize transactions and whatnot is working around the fact that it's a global ledger. What MadeSafe is doing is building all that in from the start. There is no global ledger, so you don't have to worry about that. I think blockchain technology is going to thrive in situations for accountability, so organizations. People are going to want organizations that they're working with to opt into blockchain use of blockchain technology, whereas individuals will be able to use things like SafeCoin to do transactions without having any sort of transaction recorded on a blockchain whatsoever. Yeah.
So you mentioned the first use case was data storage. So practically speaking, how do you see this happening? Would it be kind of like Dropbox where I have a MadeSafe folder and then gets...
Yep, it's basically, you can see it as like a virtual drive. So you just, when you open the MadeSafe client, it just opens a virtual drive and it has a, whatever, however much you partitioned will be allocated to the network. And yeah, so similar to how a Dropbox, there's a Dropbox folder in your on your desktop. That would be how MadeSafe will work, except obviously distributed.
You know, there's a couple other companies doing distributed cloud storage, if you will.
What do you suggest for like app developers and core developers how to get into developing for MadeSafe?
So I would definitely go to the GitHub and start diving into it. We are working on an API, so there will be easier access to the network. Just go to madesafe.org, which is the community. There's a lot of developers on there that are building projects. And again, if you, I guess if you want any specific direction, we can talk more. But generally, if you're just interested in looking at the potential, I would just go to madesafe.org and poke around the GitHub and poke around the Atlassian website just to see the development process. Is it the last one? Okay, last one.
Like with the SafeCoin or any other like cryptocurrency, if something that could rival Bitcoin, would it all have the same kind of volatility? Like, that's what I'm curious about. I want to get involved in it, but I'm also concerned about
the
like
price.
How it can drop like $150 in one day and then pick it back up again.
I can't really talk too much about how like predicting how SafeCoin will be.
Right.
I don't necessarily think about those things too much because it's more of like a long game for me. I'm more interested in what the technologies can bring. However, that said, I think maybe MadeSafe might be, there's potential for it to be less volatile just because people are constantly using it to gain access to the network. So it's not like people are, you know, just holding it and whatnot. It's gonna be in constant perpetual use. When people are uploading data and you know providing resources, so I think it'll be different than how Bitcoin acts. I just don't really know how.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, and that's it. Thanks for coming in.